This is my base bin. It's an IKEA waste paper basket. It was built with the help of Neal Spowage. And at the base of the bin there, we've got a 6-inch speaker. It's about 15 centimetres. And that's held in with some bits of wood, which are screwed into the side and into the back. And on the back there, we've got the audio input, and we've got a DC power input, and a little power LED. And built into the back here is a little IC-based audio power amplifier, which is roughly 2 watts. So for power, I've just got a pair of 9-volt batteries, and they're in series, so that gives me roughly 18 volts. And you can connect. The good thing is that makes it portable. You can just connect this up, and then you can pop these in your pocket on your person. And then the unit can be used to diffuse sound manually for, say, a stage performance. And what's quite good about this particular design with the flared horn is it's quite loud, and it has a, it can produce a lot of low frequencies in a kind of portable package. So then you would just hook up your audio input. I've just got a little test oscillator there. It's a simple oscillator with wave shaping. We'll take a look at that in a bit. So if I just hook that up, and so now I'm just going to have a closer look at my test oscillator. It's using a 555 timer, and I'm taking the kind of triangle or shark fin shaped waveform which you get from the discharge threshold pins, and I'm putting that through an op amp. And what you can do with that is, if you limit the headroom of the op amp as you turn up the amplitude of the input going in to the op amp, you kind of overload the input, and it starts clipping the signal. So by doing that, what you can do is actually wave shape. So you start with quite a triangle shaped waveform, and as you turn up the input to the op amp further and further, and the op amp hasn't got any more headroom, so it can't actually get any louder. It just starts cutting the top and bottom of the waveform off more and more, until eventually you end up with something that looks relatively square wave. So we can have a look at this on the scope. I'm just going to record this for you so you can hear a direct line input. So I turn this on. Once the DC offset is settled, you can see the waveform there. Now you can only just see the angle on the edge of the waveform to indicate that it's got a kind of triangle-esque shape. What I found is, if you start with a very triangle-shaped waveform, that actually has a sharp peak at the top and bottom of the oscillation. From a sound perspective, the change in harmonic content between this point here, where the signal has already been chopped off by an amplifier to a sharp point, there's not much change in the harmonics as far as you can hear with your ears. So what you kind of perceive it as is a change in loudness. So rather than have that, I've started with my signal like this, and as I adjust the volume of the signal at the input of the op amp, it squares off more and more and more. And now you can see that the waveform is almost entirely square. And there's quite a lot of change in the harmonic content between this waveform. This one. So visually speaking, there isn't much of a change on the oscilloscope, but from an auditory perspective, the change is quite big. And also, you can change the pitch here. Oscillator is it's got a control voltage input, and by putting a signal into here you can control the pitch, you can kind of modulate the 555 timer. So that's normally pin 5, I think, is the modulation input on your 555 timer. And if I just grab another sound source, Athens board synth that I worked on with John Richards and Stu Smith, and it's a kind of sequencer synthesizer, and it sequences a pattern of lights as well as the audio. We're just going to use this as our input source. This pot here can be used to mix in that signal. You can see it modulating the frequency.